days, and there's even some snow that has fallen in the northern valleys.
Men's suits are advertised at $19.95. That's $19.95. Eggs are 28 cents a dozen. Can of coffee, 33 cents. You can buy a T-bone steak for 12 cents a pound, or see Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde at the Paramount for, would you believe, a quarter?
The population of Los Angeles is 1.25 million, and many of them are huddled around their radios listening to a new crooner named Bing Crosby sing about the blue of the night meeting the gold of the day.
And that was as close to gold as most people could get to at this time of the Great Depression. No one was expecting miracles, but there was one happening at the same time.
On December 23rd, 1931, the first pictures were sent through the air on a regular basis. It came from the 8th floor of the Don Lee building, at a time when there were only 5 sets to receive those pictures in all of Los Angeles. But the miracle of television was beginning just the same.
And guess what? That building still stands.
And guess what else? The television station is still here, Channel 2. And we're here tonight to celebrate our 50th anniversary.
Tonight, Connie Chung and Jess Marlowe host these special guests and programs: Steve Allen, Maury Amsterdam, Marsha Brandwin, Johnny Carson Seller, Buddy Ebsen, Steve Edwards and Melody Rogers, Larry Finley and Strictly Informal, Maury Green, Tom Harmon, Jim Hill, Bill Keane, Dan Lundberg, Professor Julius Sumner Miller, Harry Owens and his Royal Hawaiians, Maclovio Perez, Peter Potter and Jukebox Jury, Cleet Roberts, Red Rowe and Panorama Pacific, Ralph Story, Gil Stratton, Bill Stout, Ruth Ashton Taylor, The Big News, and CBS Board Chairman William Paley.
Think of it, the ancestors of 60 Minutes, Dallas, and the 6 o'clock news were tinkering in this building a half century ago. Now remember, in those days, radio was hardly out of the cat's whisker stage itself. Transistors weren't dreamed of. To us today, that early equipment looks as crude as a Stone Age axe.
Even so, W6XAO, Channel 1 as they named it, began taking shape. The dream of auto dealer and broadcaster Don Lee and a young engineering student from the University of California named Harry Lubke. They began by building their own equipment from scratch. Then they tried the impossible and succeeded. They broadcast a television picture from one side of this room to the other.
After that, they just didn't know when to stop. They transmitted a picture all the way down the block. When that worked, there was literally no holding them back. They put a transmitter on the roof so they could broadcast to all of Los Angeles, to all of the city's 5 television sets.
Don't forget, in those days, you couldn't just go out and buy a set. You had to build it yourself. And if that makes you wonder what Harry's first set looked like, well, we found that particular piece of history hiding in an old downtown warehouse, the property of the County Museum of Natural History.
It was incredibly heavy, difficult to tune, and the screen was small. But then there wasn't all that much to see anyway. There weren't any real programs, not at first.
I was able to obtain the cooperation of getting the pictures from the cutting room floor of Paramount. And so we telecast those. And then subsequently, Pathé News was satisfied or willing to allow us to have their newsreels, basically, of course, when they were more or less old.
Though men like Harry Lubke didn't realize it at the time, they were making history constantly. In 1933, for instance, film of the Long Beach earthquake was quickly developed and then broadcast over the air, a first step in what was to become television news.
Another first was the invention of the TV soap opera. That early one had quite a Hollywood flavor. It was called Vine Street.
Radio waves bend and bounce, but the television signal travels in a straight line of sight. And that meant the transmitter, built here on top of the Don Lee Cadillac Agency, couldn't reach homes in the San Fernando Valley.
And with that in mind, the Don Lee Broadcasting System bought a 20-acre mountaintop on the eastern boundary of Griffith Park. Originally, it was to have been Max Sennett's answer to Hearst San Simeon, but the man who brought us the Keystone Cops ran out of money, and it was never built.
At 1,700 feet, this peak is the second highest in the city. If you look on the official maps, it's Mount Coinga.
But when W6XAO took it over, Don Lee liked the sound of Mount Lee better, and that's how most people know it today.
Whatever the name, a modern television station was built here in 1939. There was even a swimming pool.
Praise the Lord, and pass the ammunition.
Then came the war. And by the time Praise the Lord and Pass the Ammunition made the hit parade, television was put on hold for the duration. W6XAO, Channel 1, was cut back to civil defense programs, war bulletins, and the like.
But after the war, TV began coming of age. In 1946, there were approximately 400 sets in the city. 4 years later, they numbered 300,000.
We'd have variety programs, usually with a master of ceremony. One was with Maury Amsterdam.
How do you like this suit? How about this, huh? Had no intention of buying it. I was walking by a secondhand store all of a sudden. Bang!
The lights were so powerful that you just couldn't stay in front of a camera for any more than about 15 minutes at the most. We all wore completely white makeup, black lips, black around the eyes. Everybody looked like Marcel Marceau. If you'll take a look at this picture, you'll notice that the cameraman is just does it by, whatever he's doing. He points it at you like a gun, but they had no viewfinders on the cameras. That's where I started Art Carney doing comedy, because at that time he was a heavy on Gangbusters, which was a big radio show in those days.
Tonight I'm feeling like a lark, happy as a lark.
Happy as a lark, that's wonderful. How's the wife?
I feel like a dead duck.
You know what my type is? What's your type?
That there Lola, that cigarette gal you got here.
Boy. Lola? Yeah.
Boy, look at a good-looking dame like that. Ba-ba-ba-boom.
About the time people began crowding around appliance store windows to watch their favorite programs, Buttons and Bows was in the top 10, and W6XAO had moved from the mountaintop to here at 1313 Vine Street. By then, W6XAO had become KTSL and moved from Channel 1, which is now reserved for national emergency broadcasts, to Channel 2.
These days, Channel 2 is long gone from 1313 Vine, but back in the 50s, it was home to hit shows such as Queen for a Day, and CBS decided to buy Channel 2 from Don Lee. It was not the first time the two had done business. In the 30s, when Don Lee had many radio stations on the West Coast, CBS had sought to get them as affiliates. But that wasn't easy. William Paley, who is chairman of the board of CBS to this day, remembers those radio negotiations well when he spoke with Connie in his New York office.
One day I just picked up the telephone and talked to him, and I said I wanted to talk to him about the possibility of connecting up with CBS. And he said, well, young man, he said, I never discuss business over the telephone. If you want to talk business to me, you better take a train and come out here. And I got there, and I was met by one of his drivers and taken to his house. Not to his house. I was first taken to my hotel, and the driver told me to put a few things in a bag because Mr. Lee was taking me off on a yacht for a short trip. So I did that, got to his house, went to his yacht, which is a perfectly beautiful one, the fastest, the one that usually won the race to Hawaii every year. And after the first night, I approached him and said, Mr. Lee, he was still Mr. to me, not Don. I've come from New York, as you know, in order to talk business, to see whether or not we can make an arrangement whereby you affiliate with CBS, and let's talk about it. And much to my surprise, he said, Mr. Paley, there's a very strict rule on this boat. We never talk business. This is only for pleasure and fun. So we did have a very delightful trip for 4 days. Came back to Hollywood, went to the office, and he said, I'll tell you what I'll do. He pressed a button, and a secretary came in. He said, Mr. Paley is going to dictate a memorandum, which will be the basis for a contract that will associate us with CBS. And after it's all put in legal language and ready to sign, just call me, and I'll sign it. And I said, now, wait a minute, Don. By this time, he was Don to me. You can't do this to me. It's a dirty trick. He said, in what way? And I said, you know darn well, if I have to fill in the blank spaces myself, I'll lean over backwards, to give you a better deal than I would if I could fight it out.
With William Paley at the helm, things really began to move. Not only did CBS change the call letters from Don Lee's KTSL to KNXT, but decided to move its transmitter to higher ground to what's become known as Video Hill, or Mount Wilson.
By so doing, Channel 2's broadcasting power was increased tenfold. Such a move certainly called for a celebration, so a special 12-hour program was put together to inaugurate that move, and what a show it was. Steve Allen opened from New York, throwing it here to the West Coast to the Master of Ceremonies, Jack Benny, who introduced such stars as George Burns, Bob Crosby, and Martha Tilton.
And there was even a Bible reading by actor Donald Crisp, a screening of Shakespeare's As You Like It, starring Sir Laurence Olivier, and a live broadcast of the Rams 49ers football game. It was quite an inaugural broadcast.
But once an inauguration is over, a new administration has to get down to business, and that's exactly what Channel 2 did. KNXT started an ambitious schedule of local live entertainment programs. They became successful almost from the start. We now take you to the 6th annual Emmy Awards for the best programs of 1952 at the Hollywood Palladium.
Joan Leslie, ladies and gentlemen, with the best entertainment program.
Frosty Frolics, Jukebox Jury, The Lawrence Welk Show, Scoop the Writers, Spade Cooley Show, and Stairway to Stardom.
And here comes the award.
I'm delighted to present this. The Academy of Television Arts and Sciences presents its 1953 Hollywood Achievement Award for the Best Entertainment Program to Jukebox Jury.
Jukebox Jury is now in session.
Jukebox Jury at 10:30 each Saturday night, a 90-minute barometer of what records would become hits. Will it be a hit or a miss?
One by one.
We'll vote them a hit.
We'll vote them a miss.
But now before we start, may we present his musical honor, Judge Peter Potter.
Tennessee Wolf, Patti Page. Six people voted that a miss. Patti Page, It's been around close to 18 or 19 million now. Imagine how much that means to Patty. A lot of money. Oh, there's a lot of them. Volare was voted a miss.
Here they come. Tell us. Tell us, jury, will it be a hit or a miss?
Aya, down on the islands of the tropical seas. Aya, the living's easy and you're free as the breeze. Aya, you drink the fire and you do as you please.
The president and Nancy were on twice. Ronald and Nancy were on the show twice. And she would say very favorably about the record. And Ron didn't like it. I noticed he'd smile and say, well, I don't know whether I could dance that or not, and let it go at that sequence. He didn't, you know. And the other time, he would say, I like that one very much, and Nancy would keep still.
It is the opinion that the Thunderbirds on Era be sentenced to a miss.
Even though Peter now lives in Palm Springs, where he devotes much of his time to golf and playing music on the radio, he still has high hopes for the return of his jury system.
Boy, I hope it'll be on here soon. Now, as it's in London now.
If music wasn't for you, why then you could go out nightclubbing right here on Channel 2. It was called Strictly Informal. And that, says Larry Finley, who hosted the show, was exactly what it was.
I used to do my radio show from 10 at night till 4 in the morning. And one night, some fellow came up to me and he said, you ought to be on television. And I thought he was crazy. So I said, fine. And he says, give me a call. My name is Jim Aubrey at KNXT. He was then manager here. So I did nothing about it. About a week later, he came in and he gave me his business card. He says, I want you to come down and talk to me about doing a TV show. I said, I have no talent, I can't act. I ad-lib my commercials, I don't rehearse, I'm not a performer. I said, if I did a show, it would have to be a really strictly informal type of a show. He said, that's the name, Strictly Informal. And I went down, and a week later, I was on the air.
You know, I think this is a good time to introduce another singer by the name of Alan Jones that I know quite well.
Good.
This is a 17-year-old boy who has a voice that is not as good as yours, but I have hopes that someday it will be. And this is throwing a curve to our director, but stand up, Alan Jones, Jr., ladies and gentlemen.
These days, Larry Finley works behind the scenes in the tape business, but another Channel 2 pioneer is still on stage and bigger than ever. He is Steve Allen, who was part of that 1951 inaugural program. And Steve Allen remembers the good old days as not being all that good.
You know, these days, people are always talking about how bad television was. They should have seen it in 1950 and 49. Nowadays, I suppose television is about probably 60% lousy for the most part. In those days, it was about 98% lousy. It was just little occasional moments of goodness. But that was understandable. It was all brand new. None of us knew what we were doing. We were all faking it and learning on the job, you know?
Over the years, Steve has proved he is more than just a comic. He is a musician, a composer, an author, a producer, a full-fledged all-American success. As such, he has the magic solution for improving today's television. Just put him in charge.
Someone once asked me, I think it was Walter Cronkite on a special that CBS did on this about 15 years ago. He said, well, of course, it's easy enough for all of us to criticize television, as we all do. But what if you were running a network? I mean, could you do much better? So I gave him an answer that, although facetious, made a point, I think a valid point. I said, the first day I was on the job, I would call a media conference and announce my firm intention to plunge my network into third place and keep it there, despite all temptations to the contrary. And by doing that, you could indeed make it the best network. I think everyone recognizes that, and it wouldn't even be very difficult to do. And I'm not talking only about putting on opera and Shakespeare and ballet and other things that not many people, God help us, will watch. There are other things you could do which would improve television. But you would no longer be number one. So inasmuch as our television system is plugged into our economic system, the gears mesh pretty well, that means you can never improve television, commercial television.
Now that we know how to succeed in this business without really trying, let's go back to the 50s, to a real television survivor. You know him today as the Beverly Hillbilly or Barnaby Jones. You've seen them both on CBS. But back before all that fame, Buddy Ebsen didn't even know what this funny-shaped tube called television was.
It was 1942, and our publicity man came by and said, hey, they got a gadget here that they're working or fooling around with in the Balaban Cats Theater on the roof or on the penthouse. And they want you to come over and be on it. It's something called television. And I said, what is it? He said, well, it's a kind of a thing where they photograph you and they broadcast it. I said, no kidding. I went over there with Seat Gallagher and my little dog, Hobo, with whom I used to perform. He used to put a cookie in his nose and snap my fingers and he'd grab it. And do a little dance with him. And so we went on television and I saw what later upon was a monitor in one corner of the room. I saw these greenish-looking striated ghosts on this monitor and a small ghost, which is my dog. And I said, what is that? He said, well, that's you all. I said, where is that going? He says, it goes out on the air. I said, so how many sets? He says, well, they got about 57 in Illinois now. I said, this thing will never amount to anything.
For our next KNXT memory, we travel to Eugene, Oregon, where the star of a hit show of the 1950s now lives. Each Saturday night at 7:30, it was time for Harry Owens and his Royal Hawaiians. It originally started on Channel 5 and moved to KNXT, where it was sent to the entire Pacific Coast CBS network. Harry won an Oscar for composing Sweet Leilani for a Bing Crosby film, a song which became his theme.
You are my dream.
Mahalo. Thank you.
I came up to Los Angeles, made a batch of phonograph records, and went back. And then I guess look at that right out the window. The deer. Turn to the deer, will you? Oh, isn't that something to cue into this picture, into this interview? That's beautiful, isn't it? I regret to say that most of the principals have passed away. My dear Hilo Hattie. Hilo Hattie was magnificent. Most beautiful woman in the world. She passed away 2 years ago. The thought that is so much like the love and the devotion and the faith of our Hawaiian people. It went like this. We will be kind, cheerful, and friendly. Seek the good in all, the enmity in none. We will never criticize. We will make no promise we cannot keep. We will be loyal to our country and loyal to our friends. We will be calm in time of trouble, think before we speak, and every day...
Every day, by word or deed, in some unselfish way.
E ho'ohau oli ia ha'i.
We will try to make someone happy.
That's right.
Thank you. You know, I
KNXT pioneered in morning television with a live two-hour daily broadcast, Panorama Pacific. It ran for 16 years, hosted by Red Rowe.
Well, thank you very much. It's 1 minute and 30 seconds after 7 o'clock on this Thursday morning, September the 5th, 1957. And for those of you who view Panorama Pacific from the opening bell, we hope you're feeling just fine.
I got a telephone call from one of the KNXT program people saying, we've decided we'll start a morning show. And at that time, I was spinning records on KFWB and doing a soap show here on CBS Radio and another soap show on the NBC Radio. And I had requested the early morning time on radio because I thought, this will be immune from television. No one in their right mind will ever turn on a television set in the morning. Because in the first place, you couldn't see it because it would be too light. But that was my thinking. So I said, well, when were you thinking of putting this show on? They said, from 7 until 9 o'clock every morning. And I said, well, I've got to think this one over for a little bit.
These days, Red lives in Westlake, writes songs, and plays in celebrity golf tournaments.
We're in the Channel 2 announce booth. Have you ever wondered about those voices you hear on television? Well, back in the 50s, Channel 2 had a young man from Nebraska as its staff announcer.
He did station breaks, read commercials, and in 1952 was given his own Sunday afternoon show. Here's a rare surviving kinescope of that early effort.
KNXT, with its eyes wide open, cautiously presents Carson Seller. And here's the guy who has to account for this half hour, Johnny Carson.
Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you very much. The eye was supposed to cry, and at the last minute, I guess it got myopia or something, but the eye didn't cry tonight. Thank you very much for coming into the cellar tonight. It's a little bit cold tonight. In fact, I think that's why we got one young lady out there. Before the show, I said, why did you come and see the show? And she says, because it was cold outside. But we like to have an honest audience, and tonight we've got a variety of things on the cellar. Did you see the game yesterday? Television, the USC-UCLA? Of course, yesterday was a big football weekend all over the country. Because, example, out here, they had over 96,000 people in the Coliseum. And I had a couple of tickets to the game. And, of course, the game was sold out 2 days ahead of time. You couldn't buy a ticket at all. You could buy a ticket, but the only way you could get it was from a ticket scalper. Those are the fellows, you know, who buy up the tickets at regular prices. And then, just before game time, they sell them for a lot more money. And tickets were going for $20, $30, $50 a seat. $50 for a ticket. That makes me kind of mad. I'm kind of disgusted. I got a lousy $10 a piece for mine. That's all I can get. That's why I'm disgusted.
Now, here we have about an 8-pound turkey. And, of course, you must make sure that your turkey... Keep the turkey neat, and now we're ready to stuff the bird. Now, in stuffing a turkey, ladies, you must remember to don't stuff too hard. Just fill the cavity comfortably with the dressing. So, into the turkey and move it up front. So when you hold the turkey, move the dressing right down in the bottom of the turkey like that. That is the way we stuff the turkey here, and of course, if we must.
Well, he wasn't bad. Oh, whatever happened to him?
Last I heard, he was lost in the bowels of some building in Burbank. In a moment, we'll take you back to when television news came of age. Charlie?
Coming up next, the big news on Channel 2's Golden Anniversary Special. Stay with us.
Only one candidate for governor has the credentials and experience we need. Only one worked 21 years on the police force. Only one proved he's a tough fiscal manager by balancing 8 consecutive budgets. And only one helped create 200,000 new private sector jobs. He's Tom Bradley. And now, after years of hard work, he's running for governor to pull our state together and to build a better future for all of us. Elect Tom Bradley governor. He doesn't make a lot of noise. He just gets a lot done.
When Brian Phillips became a Los Angeles firefighter, he promised the city he'd give them his best.
My husband was killed while fighting an arson fire. Brian kept his promise. He died keeping his promise. Now the politicians want to break theirs. The promise they made to help us when tragedy strikes.
It's an outrage. Don't break the promise. Vote no on H. It's just not right.
Murder, rape, robbery, violent crime is up 55% in 5 years. Since liberal courts stopped capital punishment, murder is up 5 times. Unless we fight weak laws in courts, you or someone you know will be a victim too. That's why Senior Assistant Attorney General George Nicholson wrote the Victims' Bill of Rights. George Nicholson is fighting for us. He's a professional prosecutor.
I'm George Nicholson. I know what it takes to put a killer on death row because I've done it. As your Attorney General, I'll make the death penalty work again.
Stalin said, a diplomat's words must have no relation to actions. Good words conceal bad deeds.
Does anyone really believe we can trust Soviet Russia?
The Soviets are behind the Cuban intrusion in the Third World, the occupation of Afghanistan, the domination of Poland. And they talk about peace at Geneva and the UN?
In the United States Senate, you'll know where I stand on Soviet Russia. Russia has a lot to prove to me and a lot to prove to the free world.
Barry Goldwater, a tradition.
News has always been a vital part of KNXT. Its first newscast was the 10 o'clock report.
The program featured Ruth Ashton, Tom Harmon with sports, and Dan Lundberg with the local news. These days, Dan publishes the prestigious Lundberg Letter, which focuses on the ins and outs of the oil industry. We caught up with him in his North Hollywood office.
The interesting thing now, when I look at the screen and I see that handsome anchor man and I see those credits, the credits are so long that they're almost as long as some of the segments you put on. And I think back at the time that I had absolutely no one, not even a secretary, to answer a phone. In fact, no office. We simply covered the news and then walked in with a sheaf of notes and did it right there and then. That's how it was.
I can remember one time it was raining, and the director we had that particular evening, who had his own little sense of humor or feeling for visuals, decided that in order to transmit this idea of rain outside, we didn't have any cameras outside, Tom Harmon and I would walk in with an umbrella that was dripping. So as we came onto the set, one of the stagehands threw a bucket of water on our umbrella, and we walked in with a dripping umbrella. In a sense, I'd say it was kind of casual for the most part.
Those were the fun days of television. We had a ball. We had some great news people, some great guys, and they never lost their sense of humor. We would always attempt, without management knowing it, to try and break everybody up on the air. If you could break somebody up, that was an accomplishment. So what was going on behind that camera, which the public could never see, it was some real wild affairs.
Then came the era of Cleet Roberts, a man so dedicated to the news in the mid-50s that he was willing to pay money out of his own pocket to cover it.
You had to indulge in a little bit of intrigue to get something done. For example, I covered the Suez Crisis in Israel and Egypt, and I covered the Hungarian Revolution, at least the fringes of the revolution. I got to the border at the time there was so much trouble up there near Eisenstadt in Austria. And to do that, I had to take a leave of absence from Channel 2, as I recall, get a letter of authority from the news director identifying me as a legitimate correspondent of CBS KNXT, pay my own fare to the Middle East, furnish my own camera, and hire my own cameraman and go over there on speculation. But once I got there, unfortunately I got there the day the war broke out in Israel, I was immediately put on payroll again by KNXT, and they were trumpeting in the press here that they had sent me over there, and I didn't argue with them. All I wanted was to get my broadcasts on the air.
When the Beatles song Yesterday was hitting the top 10 charts and Americans were walking in outer space, Channel 2 moved here to Columbia Square on Sunset Boulevard.
For decades, this had been the radio flagship for CBS Radio on the West Coast, but the emphasis was now shifting, and the scene was now set for the television explosion of the 60s.
From man's new frontier, the limitless reaches of space,
from the world we live in, from the United States of America, from Los Angeles, comes the story of today, the big news.
The big news. There was nothing like it anywhere.
Good evening, Jerry Dunphy, and tonight's big news in color.
It was an entire hour of news, and skeptics practically stood in line to say the viewers wouldn't put up with that much information all at one time.
Even some of the news people had their doubts. Weatherman Bill Keene, who's still featured on KNX Radio today, remembers how it all started.
There used to be a saloon across the street called Naples. Bless its heart. But anyway, one night, Sam Zellman, who was then the KNXT news director, and Bob Wood, who was then general manager, said, we want to see you guys over here right after the news tonight. We all got in and had a couple of suds, and that sort of smoothed things over a bit. I think there was a little planning in there, having it at the Naples, because at this point, when we were all fairly mellow, Sam Zellman dropped it on us, said, fellas, we're going to do an hour of news. An hour of news? An hour of news? Yeah, we're going to do an hour. How?
Hello there, everybody. Time to call them as we see them.
Sports reporter Gil Stratton, a man famed for covering horse races, wouldn't have wanted to cover bets on chances of the big news success.
Everybody said, well, it was Bob Wood, was general manager of the station, and who later became president of the network, as you well know. And Bob wanted to go with the hour of news, and a lot of people, including me, said, who's going to sit and watch an hour of news? Are you kidding me? And, you know, now what are the station doing 2.5 hours? But it was his foresight, really. Bob Wood is the guy you got to give credit to. And then the old big news started, and probably there will never be a television news show like that as far as ratings are concerned.
Maury Green was a featured reporter. Doubts about success never entered his mind. He just counted himself lucky to be part of the big news team.
There was a kind of electricity among everybody who worked here. And we were a very small crew. We just went out and did things. For example, they closed 2 of the 4 metropolitan newspapers in Los Angeles on a Saturday. We discovered on Thursday that they were going to announce the closing and do it on Saturday. We went out and covered the show, the story, I mean. We devoted the first 18 minutes of the big news that night to that story. We beat the newspapers at their own story by 2 days. We blew people's minds. We did something like that 2 or 3 times a week.
When it came to hard-nosed investigation, Bill Stout was the man then, as he is today. His memories of the big news are filled with the genius of news director Sam Zellman.
One thing he believed was that news could be made profitable, and that controversy, which had always been, and still is in many ways to this day, always been a dirty word in broadcasting, could also be profitable, could be useful as a matter of interest to the audience, and could make money. Well, 60 Minutes is the final and ultimate proof that he had the right idea, and that the cautious and the timid who were afraid of news and afraid of controversy were wrong.
Bill Stout's memories go back even further to the first time he remembers television.
I was working in Minneapolis when the coaxial cable came through from New York and Chicago, and television arrived in that city. It was a great event. Theater marquees, and billboards, newspapers, radio stations, streetcars, they had streetcars that long ago, all had signs on them saying C-Day or whatever they called it, or TV Day, I've forgotten. It was a long time ago. I'm still not sure it was a good idea. Television, I mean.
But the viewers of the 60s didn't have any doubts. Television viewership reached new highs. Second sets and households plus color became the norm. Channel 2's public affairs programs, which had brought Shakespeare to television in the 50s with the late Dr. Frank Baxter, continued into the 60s with such programs as Repertory Workshop, which featured scripts and performances by newcomers, plus primetime documentaries.
Then, every Saturday afternoon, Professor Julius Sumner Miller, also known as Professor Wonderful on the Mouseketeer program, brought the magic of science to people of all ages.
I'm Julius Sumner Miller. I teach physics.
The physics, you see, that I taught was down to earth so the man in the street could follow it. Men of science are given to the view that their stuff is too esoteric, too high in the clouds for the man and the woman on the path to understand. But physics has always been, for me, sort of a homely thing. You see, children are endowed abundantly with curiosity. And I'm grieved to tell you, as Einstein said, the schools destroy the holy spirit of curiosity. To put it in a phrase, boys and girls are emerging from every level, at every level, with diplomas and certificates and degrees, who can't write, can't read, can't calculate. This is scandalous. And fortunes are spent. And the claim of the schools and the school officers is, we don't get enough money. I can do better with less. I could have a very good class under an apple tree. Don't need a classroom. Maybe a blackboard.
As we left his El Segundo home, where he is ready and waiting for his next television series, he left us with this thought.
If every day you learn one little single thing, and you live 70 years, would you not have gathered up a handsome body of knowledge? Which has been my ambition all my years. To convey a body of knowledge which, when added together, little piece by little piece, in infinitesimal accretion, layer by layer, would not this do something for you in all your years?
There was always something to be learned on Channel 2 during the 60s. For those who wanted to know something about their town, Ralph's story was to provide an answer.
I did the news for several years, and gradually the human predicament began to take on serious news stories. Actually, I had done some coverage of the Middle East for CBS Radio and had some experience in that field, but I hadn't used it on television. And so gradually the human predicament wasn't just a funny piece on the news every night. And as that evolved, I said, hey, you're asking me to go on the air every night and say Beirut or whatever the capital was that was in the news. I don't know anything about it. And if I'm going to do this and do this properly, I have got to have the background for it. So in 1963, I quit. And Bob Wood said, you will never come back to CBS. Your name, you'll die in a year. No one will ever hear of you. And I think he's right. You can disappear pretty quickly from television. But so I went around the world in 1963, slowly, on a boat, to see all the places that I'd been talking about and to see places that I was going to talk about. And to, in a sense, give myself the journalistic education I didn't have. What I didn't count on was the fact that Bob Wood loved to make marine telephone calls. And wherever I went, he called from the office up here. Hello, Ralph, how is Australia? Ready to come back? I said, gee, Bob, I just got here, you know? He called me every single, once a month, all the way around the world. The last call was at a little town called Molde, Norway. I remember it very clearly. Because he said, I think we've got something you'll be interested in. Of course, this is 9 months later now. Think we've got something you'll be interested in.
If you have a nagging suspicion that there's something familiar about our latest civic crisis, you're right. Once again, we are told that Los Angeles desperately needs a really efficient rapid transit system. Once again, we are warned that the alternative is strangulation on our own traffic. And once again, experts from City Hall to State House are struggling with this same old problem. Well, if they want to struggle, that's their privilege, I guess. But they really don't have to. Last year, right here on this program, we presented a solution, and they ignored it. But undismayed and full of the spirit of public service, we hereby offer it again, a really efficient rapid transit system. Now, how does this blueprint strike you? 1,200 miles of glistening track, 800 electric cars, take you any place you want to go, and for just a dime. How far ahead do we have to look? 1980, 1990 perhaps? No, 1926. That's right, 1926, for back then, we in Los Angeles had the greatest rapid transit system in the world. We had it, and then we threw it away. The old red cars were great. They went every place.
When we come back, the turbulent 70s.
I believe the biggest task we face is making government our own again.
People throughout California support Carol Hallett for Lieutenant Governor.
As Assembly Republican leader, I've worked to make the changes people want and deserve. Less government, lower taxes, more freedom to create the jobs we desperately need, and return to a judicial system that protects citizens and punishes criminals. As Lieutenant Governor, I want to continue that work.
Now more than ever, Carol Hallett for Lieutenant Governor.
Who is the only Republican U.S. Senate candidate endorsed by every major conservative organization? Bob Dornan. Who did Newsweek magazine say had an unblemished conservative record? Bob Dornan. Who was selected as one of the 10 most admired conservatives in Congress and was endorsed 6-1 over other Republicans by the California Republican Assembly? Bob Dornan. Who will be the United States Senator President Reagan can count on? Bob Dornan. Call now and help elect Bob Dornan to the United States Senate.
Denny's introduces our senior citizen specials for people 55 or over. Roast breast of turkey. Succulent grilled ham. Crisp, juicy fried chicken. Spaghetti and meatballs. Tender fillet of fish. Our rich, hearty beef stew. Each with soup or salad for the special introductory price of only $2.45. Denny's, where you'll like our prices and you'll love our food.
Everything you wanted to know about L.A., but didn't know how to ask.
Why do you watch Two on the Town?
We watch Two on the Town because my husband's in love with Melody Rogers.
They do things that appeal to most people.
Oh, my whole family watches it.
They go into everything.
It's a good show.
It's fun. It's entertaining.
Especially the travel segments.
I mean, not everybody gets to go around the world, but you watch it on television, you can.
It's a nice thing to watch while you're having dinner.
7:30 every night, Monday through Friday. Channel 2.
With the 70s came still another revolution. It was called ENG, Electronic News Gathering. And Channel 2 was the first television station in Los Angeles to switch from film to videotape and the live look.
Gone were those back-breaking, shoulder-mounted film cameras that were so bulky. Now we had this new technology, which made it possible for more and more stories to be covered while they were occurring.
It didn't take long for Channel 2's equipment to prove itself. The year was 1974. It was a Friday night, and KNXT had the only live unit at the scene when Los Angeles police moved in on the Symbionese Liberation Army. Authorities thought they had found Patty Hearst at last, but instead, this deadly confrontation was broadcast into millions of living rooms.
We're going to try to get a better picture of the house that's being attacked by police. We're going to move out right now. This is Bill Diaz of 55. And Compton.
Between those two rows of houses, see that yellow house with a little porch on it?
Yeah.
That's got to be the target house. Now, if you look close, you'll see fire going both in and out. See that rag bobbing up and down in the gunfire?
Okay,
there's an enormous amount of fire being concentrated on that yellow house. See the...
Can you indicate to us which side is the police target? They aiming to go this way or that direction? Which way is it?
They're going this way.
Away. In that direction. All right, so that they're concentrating the fire from these two corners onto that white house with the two windows that we can see there?
All right, as far as I can determine, you've got as close as I have.
Look out there. That's bad. That's bad. Get back, guys. We just took a ricochet or a direct.
Yeah,
I don't know which.
That was a. We just got missed by a bullet. Oh, I don't.
It
that's
went
close
to the house right beside us here.
Oh,
it's getting gassed again. Maybe we better move.
Move back a little bit. Stay low, Rich.
We got a lot of gas.
Oh, that gas is incredible.
Shit, I gave Jimmy money.
Ouch.
Thank you.
Sure makes you want to get to some fresh air pretty quickly. Oh, my gosh. We got a whiff and a half. This place is getting filling up with police. They're taking weapons. A police with an automatic weapon has pulled it out. He put the magazine in his weapon. He's apparently going to put a bulletproof vest or a flak jacket or something on. He's reaching into his duffel bag. Other police officers, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, they're hauling us back. They're hauling us back. They're moving us back. They're moving us back.
Easy.
Okay, hold it. Take it easy. Don't panic. Okay, the police are moving us back.
While many cams roam Southern California, a different kind of history is being made here in Studio 22.
History is no stranger here. This was once a great radio studio, and if you listen really carefully, you might be able to hear the echoes of those old shows. Jack Benny, Amos and Andy, Edgar Bergen and Charlie McCarthy.
But when those great radio shows gave way to television, history still was made here in Studio 22. It was from here President Jimmy Carter broadcast his town meeting in 1977.
I'm Connie Chung.
And I'm Joseph Benty.
President Carter will be here in just a moment talking face-to-face with the people of Southern California for about an hour on television for the first time. Some of the people are here in our audience. They are a representative group selected at random to join us here in the studio.
And then many more people are waiting at 5 remote locations around Southern California also to ask questions of the president. Those live cameras are located in the San Fernando Valley, in South Los Angeles, in East Los Angeles, and on the UCLA campus in Westwood, and in Orange County. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
And now the 80s are upon us, and Channel 2 News is still expanding. Our Sunday news has recently gone to a full hour.
Of course, we've been doing 2.5 hours of news every weekday from here for a long time. Connie and I, as you know, anchor one of those hours. Ralph Story and Marcia Brandwin do the other. Marcia has not always wanted to be a journalist, at least not when she first saw television.
When were those wonderful Sunday morning programs on where they had little girl tap dancers and wonderful amateur hours? That's the first television that I remember seeing. My dream was to be on one of those shows, tapping away.
And just what does a professional like Marcia look for when she watches news on television?
I watch it for the news value. I ignore the people telling me the news. They generally, for my own taste, are the least important part of a news program for me. However, I know for most other people it's probably the most important part. Thank goodness, otherwise I wouldn't have a job.
One of Marcia's colleagues on the news is sports reporter Jim Hill. You remember, he's the guy who put his body where his mouth is. He was once a mean defensive back for the Green Bay Packers, later for the San Diego Chargers before he went into broadcasting. Mean? Well, you had to be mean growing up where he did, although his first TV did help a bit.
We didn't know what in the world to expect. And when it came on, we were totally amazed to see people on a little box. They were talking and laughing and joking. It was one of the biggest things that happened in our neighborhood at that particular time, because growing up in South Texas was not one of the greatest places in the world to grow up. You've heard of the dead-end street where you had to have a fight at least once a day. Well, I had two, you know, getting in and getting out. So, but once we got the television set, that kind of calmed everything down a little bit.
No wonder he made it into professional football, but being a professional has its drawbacks.
For so long, athletes have had the reputation of being big, dumb, and ugly. And we're trying to change that. We may be big, and we may be ugly, but we don't think we're dumb anymore.
It's not just athletes and sports reporters who have image problems. Take weathermen, for example.
Nobody remembers their accurate forecasts. Everybody just remembers their goofs. But Maclovio Perez takes it all in stride.
There are times when people blame you. One case in San Diego. I said it wasn't going to rain, and it rained. And there was this guy playing golf at Torrey Pines, as a matter of fact. I know it very well because he left his clubs on the 13th tee, went to close the car windows, and came back, and his clubs were missing. And he wanted to sue me for the golf clubs.
If you'll stick around for just a moment,
you can meet our boss.
Without Proposition 9, droughts will force water rationing. Without Proposition 9, food prices will go up. Without Proposition 9, jobs will be lost. It's worth a dollar a month not to run out of water. Yes on water. Yes on 9.
I say, Holmes, don't you think that all orange juice is the same?
Not so, Watson.
If you think all orange juice is the same,
Tropicana's gonna change your mind.
I changed my mind. Change? Lord.
Godfrey Daniels, I've changed my mind.
If you think all orange juice is the same,
Tropicana's gonna change your mind.
Frenchie, I've changed my mind.
Tropicana's gonna change your mind.
The Channel 2 Consumer Team. Donna Diener with expert advice to protect you. Health and science editor Glenda Wiener with tomorrow's medical advances today. Hollywood correspondent Gary Franklin. His scale takes the hit or miss out of your entertainment spending. Greengrocer Joe Cartione with advice that's always in season. The Consumer Team. Looking out for you. They make Channel 2 News the team to watch.
San Francisco Chronicle. The California poll says the Republican with the best chance to stop Jerry Brown is Pete McCloskey. Editor of the California Journal, McCloskey would be virtually unbeatable in November. Los Angeles Times news story. Brown aide says Pete McCloskey would be Brown's biggest problem. Sacramento Bee pollster Mervyn Field says Pete McCloskey would be 3-1 to beat Jerry Brown, far better than Wilson or Goldwater Jr. The message is clear. Pete McCloskey is the Republican who can get rid of Jerry Brown.
The name synonymous with CBS is William S. Paley. He's a legend in the broadcasting industry, and this story could not be told without him. In his New York office, William Paley spoke with Connie.
What would you personally like to do next?
Oh, goodness. Well, I've always been very interested in the creative side of what we do here, radio and television and now cable. And we've gone into the motion picture business. We're making motion pictures now. And so if one is at CBS these days, he has plenty to do and a lot of exciting things to think about and treat with, because it's just all bursting out all over. And it's, if any complaint, it's just that things are going too fast. You haven't got time to sort of catch up. You have to anticipate much faster than you ever had to anticipate before. And those of us in it, I think we complain about it, but at the same time, we like it. It's fun, it's challenging, and it's, it's part of that spirit, competitive spirit, I guess, that gives you so much fun and satisfaction when you win, and gives you such heartaches, and gives you such depressions when you don't. That's part of the fun of the business. You're always reaching for something new.
Well, Jess, that's just about the end of our program. We're about up to date.
Not so fast. There's still a future, but it'll have to wait a minute.
Jerry Brown's redistricting plan is totally unfair. This unfair remapping means taxation without representation for 3 million Californians. Self-serving, outrageously unfair, and simply unacceptable, says the San Jose Mercury News. The San Diego Union calls it a fiasco. Another headline named it a travesty of greed. Tell Jerry Brown and the professional politicians no. Help stop what the Herald Examiner calls the disease that hurts democracy. Vote no on 10, no on 11, no on 12.
Police officer mourns at the funeral of two officers murdered in Riverside. Californians demand protection against the criminals. They're looking for the right person to do the job. Law enforcement has considered all of the candidates for attorney general. Every major law enforcement group in the state, police chiefs, sheriffs, line officers, have endorsed Dave Sterling.
I'm Dave Sterling. As attorney general, I pledge to change the criminal justice system so that once again, it protects the people it should be protecting.
Puzzled over who should be superintendent of schools? Who fought to teach our children the basics? Wilson Riles. Who fought to upgrade our standards of achievement? Wilson Riles. Who fought to restore discipline and respect in the classroom? Wilson Riles. It's no puzzle. Wilson Riles is the best candidate for superintendent of schools. That's why Senator Alan Cranston, parents, teachers, and school administrators are supporting Wilson Riles. After all, the children are the future.
This is an urgent SOS.
Los Angeles taxpayers are being bled by runaway pension costs. The system is billions of dollars in debt and headed for a financial disaster. Mayor Bradley says Charter Amendment H must be approved to avoid serious cutbacks in police and fire protection. Amendment H, fair pension reform before it's too late. SOS, on H, vote yes.
What about you, Connie? What do you see in our future?
Well, there's something coming up, but why don't we let our own two on the town, Melody Rogers and Steve Edwards, tell us about it.
Hello, Connie.
Hi, Jess.
You never know what you have to do to get a shot for Two on the Town.
When they told us they were going to put us on a billboard, that wasn't exactly what I had in mind. How
well,
about you?
There we were on the billboard, not for very, very long. You know, Two on the Town is a relatively recent addition to KNXT. We've been here for 4 years. Connie, you remember the first two because you were on Two on the Town. We were once a week. And then 2 years ago, a couple of big things happened. One, we went to five nights a week. And two, we found Melody Rogers.
Yeah, when they told me I was going to be on Two on the Town, I didn't know what I was in for. I don't think we found out what town it is yet. We've been in the past year to Israel, Egypt.
To Australia, New Zealand, Tahiti.
Mexico, Alaska.
Hawaii, to London, to Dublin, to Belfast.
I think they're going to call the show next year Jet Lag.
Yeah, it's a good idea. Don't forget, we're with you every night at 7:30 throughout the summer and into our fifth season. Glad we could stop by on the anniversary show. Bye-bye.
Jess, Connie, back to you.
Try as we did, there was no way we could cram 50 years of broadcasting into a single hour. So we apologize to those of you we were forced to leave out.
To you then, the men and women who pioneered W6XAO and KTSL and KNXT, we dedicate this program to you. And without you, we wouldn't be here today.
Good night.
And we hope to see you again in 50 years.
Connie Chung takes an in-depth look at both sides of the peripheral canal issue on the Channel 2 News, coming up next.